The whole of Ithaca knows you're off to Sparta, expecting to bring back Tyndaris' daughter as your wife. News spreads quickly on a small island, Odysseus, and the crew of Coronis' ship was full of it. Your dim-witted guards may not know it yet, but it doesn't take an oracle to guess what you're up to.
Eperitus realised the braggart was one of Eupeithes' twin henchmen, mentioned at the Carosia. As he had listened to the debate about these would-be usurpers, he had felt his hatred growing with each mention of their names. A man must be loyal to his king, his grandfather had taught him, or social order falls into chaos. Only by accepting authority can a man receive the rewards of order and peace. That is why his grandfather had told him to obey three things unfailingly: his gods, his oaths, and his king. Without these principles, the world of men would fall into the abyss. Eperitus's eyes narrowed with anger. He shrugged off Odysseus's restraining hand and advanced on Polybus. The sneering braggart looked at him with disdain, as if offended that he should dare approach him, but soon retreated as he realized his intentions. An instant later, Eperitus swung his fist into Polybus's face and watched with satisfaction as he fell backwards into the waters of the spring, blood pumping from his lips and broken nose. "That's what I think of traitors," he spat. "Tell Eupeithes that Laertes will remain king of Ithaca, and if anyone is to replace him, it will be Odysseus, the only man who can claim that right." Polybus scrambled out of the pool, helped by his friends. He was incandescent with rage, and in a deft movement whipped out a dagger from beneath his tunic. He lunged with the weapon, but Eperitus brought his shield round and knocked him to one side. Quickly stepping back, he pulled the sword from his belt and faced Polybus's six companions, who held daggers of their own. In the same moment, he was joined by Odysseus and the rest of the guard, spears and shields at the ready.